My name is Helgi Steinar, stand-up comedian, independent journalist, and enthusiast of all things global. My documentaries have brought me to places like China, the British Isles, and even the radioactive ghost towns of Chernobyl. In my travels, I try to make sense of these places by talking to the locals, checking out their comedy scenes, and exploring the diverse cultures that shape the very world we live in today. On this episode of Unplugged Borders, I wanted to explore something that you may have seen on the news in the past few months. It has to do with a certain political clusterfuck known as Brexit, and the effects of it go well beyond how much a spread of Marmite will cost on future pieces of toast.
People fear that the UK's plans to leave the European Union could usher in a new age of sectarian violence, 20 years after a peace deal ended on the decades-long conflict known as the Troubles.
They're worried that if Northern Ireland has a hard border with the Republic of Ireland, we've been talking about that for some time, militant groups would flourish once again.
Now, for those of you too young to remember, put down your avocados for a minute and listen up, because this shit is actually quite serious. Car bombs, such as this one that exploded just this past January in front of a courthouse in Derry, were actually quite common in Northern Ireland in the decades leading up to 1998. In order to gain a further understanding of what's going on there, we decided to head on down to Northern Ireland and meet up with some of my friends who work in the local comedy scene. Now, we could have talked to reporters or historians, but personally, I've always found cynicism to be the most honest form of dialogue. And let's be honest, nobody is more cynical than someone who volunteers to be paid in beer. Now, if you don't know what's been going on in Northern Ireland, or, like myself, you received an education in America, this might all seem a bit confusing. So, let's go ahead and put this all into context, shall we?
We're here at the Giant's Causeway in Northern Ireland, about 60 miles north of Belfast. Now, the lava plateau here was actually formed about 50 million years ago in a gigantic volcanic eruption. Now, according to Gaelic mythology, the causeway was actually built by an Irish giant by the name of Finn McCool. Now, the legend goes that Finn was challenged to a fight by a Scottish giant who lived about 25 miles across the coast. Now, being the bad swimmer that Finn was, he decided to build the causeway so that the two of them could meet up and have their fight. Now, the ironic part of that story is that the very idea of two opposing sides meeting up with one another to settle their differences with violence is something that this country is sadly all too familiar with.
Units waited behind the army barricades, ready to launch an arrest operation. They were members of the 1st Battalion of the Parachute Regiment, known to be one of the toughest regiments serving in Northern Ireland. Shooting had begun when a soldier opened fire on an alleged nail bomber. In all, 108 rounds of live ammunition were fired by the army.
This afternoon, 27 people were shot in the city. Thirteen of them lie dead tonight. They were innocent. We were there. This is our Sharpeville. This is our Amritsar massacre.
By the end of 1975, the ceasefire was over. The IRA felt they'd been conned. The government, they concluded, had no intention of making a political withdrawal. The Brits had put great pressure on the IRA, but not enough to make it give in or compromise.
In the heart of a staunchly Republican border town, the Union flag mourns for 9 policemen and women killed by the provisional IRA. They died as they spent a few moments at ease from the Troubles in Newry Police Station's backyard canteen. The little wooden cabin was reduced to splinters. It had been crammed with officers taking their tea time break and was hit directly, killing 9 of the 20 people inside.
Shortly after midnight, two IRA men, 23-year-old Martin McCaughey and 37-year-old Desi Grew, died here, shot dead by SAS soldiers. Their death prompted allegations they were victims of a shoot-to-kill policy.
The police and army again stayed on the periphery, avoiding any confrontation with the mourners. All this points up the IUC's difficulty in nationalist areas. If they police funerals closely, there may be a riot. If they stay at a distance, the provisionals fill the vacuum, trying, as they've done for years, to create an alternative state in nationalist areas.
Slaughter in Loughan Island as loyalist terrorists
shoot 11 people in the back as they watch the World Cup on television.
A massive car bomb in Northern Ireland has killed more than 20 people, including children. It exploded in a busy shopping street in Omagh, County Tyrone. About 100 people have been injured. It's the worst bomb attack in 30 years of terrorism in the province.
So how did Northern Ireland get to the point where this kind of violence was just a normal part of everyday life? Well, for starters, Northern Ireland didn't always exist. Let's do a quick rundown of Irish history. The first inhabitants are thought to have landed in Ireland between 8 and 7,000 BC. Irish culture gradually began to form with the arrival of the Celts in 1200 BC, and this gave rise to Irish Gaelic, the Irish language so eloquently sung by this dude. Now, a few centuries later, a guy by the name of St. Patrick was kidnapped and brought to Ireland as a slave at the age of 16. He managed to escape, however, and eventually returned back to Ireland after hearing the voice of God.
Dum, 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 dum.
He began preaching Christianity, building several churches, and teaching the Irish all about the concept of Trinity.
Trinity. The Trinity?
Well, kind of. See, by using the shamrock as an example, the three-leafed clover, he highlighted the Christian belief in the idea of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, thus giving Ireland its national symbol and giving the rest of the world a reason to get absolutely shit-faced every year on March 17th.
Look at me! I'm the Prime Minister of Ireland!
Beginning in 795 AD, my dickhead ancestors were the ones who began raiding the coasts of Ireland, trying to steal their women and treasure, and were doing so all the way up until the year 1014, when the Vikings were finally defeated at Clontarf in Dublin.
Hinga-dinga-durgan.
Now, the Normans arrived in the 12th century, but it wasn't until a few centuries later that the origins of modern Northern Ireland began. Starting with something called the Plantation of Ulster in 1609, where land was colonized and forfeited from native Gaelic chiefs and given to Scottish and English colonists. Now, the idea behind that was to quote-unquote civilize the province of Ulster, and also to, of course, cut off their Gaelic links with the Highlands of Scotland. The colonists were actually all required to be English-speaking, Protestants, and loyal to the king. This would be the thing that would create a lasting Protestant presence in Ulster, with the effects of it still being felt to this day. The next few centuries were marred by bloodshed and carnage, with generals like Oliver Cromwell murdering every single Catholic he came across, and rebellions against the English by guys like Wolfetone in 1798. Now, in the years following, Ireland would suffer probably the worst chapter in the country's history, with a period known as Anno Crasmore, or the Great Hunger. But you might probably know it more by its colloquial term, the Irish Potato Famine. Between 1845 and 1852, millions of Irish died of starvation or starvation-related diseases. This resulted in a mass migration, with desperate Irish families setting sail on so-called coffin ships that would hopefully bring them to America in one piece. The ones who survived the journey settled down in the New World, giving their descendants a reason to return back to their old country, as they themselves were technically Irish. After all, their great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather's dinosaur had once lived in Cork. In the late 1800s, the Irish began getting a little frustrated with English rule and formed the Land League, which was aimed at promoting a political way of dealing with the crown, and also refusing to deal with the landlords who unfairly evicted tenants. In 1916, a rebellion was finally launched known as the Easter Rising, and although it technically failed, the men who were executed as a result became martyrs for a movement that would eventually give Ireland its independence in 1922. The British, however, still retain 6 counties up in the north and still control them up until this day. Now, the Catholic minority who had been living in this predominantly Protestant-ruled piece of British territory had faced decades of discrimination, and they were not alone. By 1968, a wave of uprisings began springing up all around the world. Americans were protesting the Vietnam War, there were riots in Paris, Berlin, Mexico, Prague. It was just a general sense that the entire world was on fire. Now, historical events like this had happened before, but this time it was different. This time, these movements were globally televised, and a shared sense of solidarity gave those who took part in them more confidence that they could enact change as well. Now, inspired partly by Martin Luther King's March on Selma, Catholics in Northern Ireland began marching for civil rights as well, and demanding basic freedoms, employment, equal representation, and housing opportunities. The problem is, the friction between the Protestants and the Catholics would eventually escalate to a level where the British Army had to be sent in to maintain the peace. Or so they thought. The IRA viewed them simply as an occupying force, and the situation only became more violent, peaking in the early 1970s with dozens and sometimes hundreds of people dying each year. After that, Ulster's reputation was more or less set in stone.
Now, unfortunately, one of the things that dominated the news here in Northern Ireland over the past few decades was a period known as the Troubles, a conflict that spanned over 3 decades from the late 1960s all the way up until the Good Friday Agreement in 1998, where Unionist paramilitary forces loyal to the Crown fought against the IRA, who were hoping for a united Ireland, a conflict that would eventually lead to the deaths of 3,600 people.
Now, we realized the only way to truly understand the divide in Northern Ireland was to experience it firsthand. So we hired a cab to show us around the borders that split Belfast into Catholic and Protestant neighborhoods. The thing that really surprised us, however, is just how close these areas are to one another. I mean, one would think that after decades of hatred and civil unrest, that people would choose to live as far away from their adversaries as possible. But Belfast is only about 115 square kilometers in size, making it the same size as Dublin and twice as small as my hometown of Reykjavik. And with a population of roughly 280,000, these areas are bound to overlap. The 21-mile-long border stretch, ironically nicknamed the Peace Lines, were first drawn up in 1969 at the start of the Troubles, and were originally only meant to be temporary. But because of their effectiveness, they not only became a permanent part of life in Belfast, but got even higher as the years went on. The most prominent peace wall lies in West Belfast, dividing the nationalist Falls Road with the unionist Shankill Road, and living right next to one of these peace walls can be a bit challenging.
So our driver just explained to us that the people who live on this side of the road, as you can see, use these grills, cages, so to speak, in their backyard. The wall here wasn't always this high, so this is something that they needed to protect themselves, and especially come July during the Unionist marches and the bonfire, you can see the other side, the Unionists, putting up the final touches on the bonfire, and it's quite an interesting time to be here apparently.
Now, the bonfires I'm referring to are these ones right here. Nope, that's not Baghdad during the 2003 invasion. That is Belfast, every year on the 11th of July, just before the Unionist parades take place the very next day, where Loyalist marching bands walk through the streets of Belfast, celebrating the victory of Protestant King William of Orange over the Catholic King James II at the Battle of the Boyne in 1690. While we were visiting the Unionist side, we actually caught a brief glimpse of what one of these marches looked like. Now, one might think that this is simply a friendly neighborhood marching band, but the armored police vehicle following it reminds you of its political significance. Being an atheist myself, I can't imagine what it's like to live somewhere where every aspect of your life is determined whether you're a Catholic or a Protestant. But the irony is, the actual religious element doesn't even seem to be relevant here. I had to ask our driver, how many of these people who staunchly identify themselves as Catholic or Protestant actually attend church service on Sundays or could even quote you a Bible verse on the spot? He gave a good answer. He simply said, if we were actually practicing our religion, we wouldn't need these peace walls in the first place. And there you have it. It's not about religion. It's about identity. It's about tribalism. It's my side versus your side. It's Coke versus Pepsi with car bombs. It's a culture of revenge that Liam Neeson actually talked about in that interview he gave, which freaked everyone out a few weeks ago.
I had acquaintances who were involved in the Troubles. The bigotry. One Catholic would be killed. The next day, a Protestant would be killed. One Catholic pub would be bombed. A Protestant pub would be bombed. I grew up surrounded by that, but I was never part of it.
What impressed me, however, is the amount of art this seems to have inspired. I mean, everywhere you go in Belfast, there's a mural honoring a fallen hero or telling some story about a historical event, all the way right down to the most obscure reference.
Who's the lad behind the dustbins?
This guy here. Actually, I have no idea. So Belfast is, there's a street, if you're here tomorrow, are you?
Yeah.
So there's like a street art tour on Sundays, which is run by a friend of mine called Adam Turkington. And he sort of does a tour around this area and she will explain to you what all these murals are about.
Yeah.
Which is in contrast to the ones on the gable walls with the guys with the guns. Sort of stuff. So like there's all this kind of new fancy hipster street art, some might say.
It's quite an interesting.
On Instagram, this must be the most photographed street.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, this is actually a good photograph here.
So, in the Duke of York bar, Gerry Adams apparently used to work there in the, I think it was the 70s or something, you know, from Sinn Féin. If you come up here, there's a whole bunch of murals. So, like, this is the wall of
Northern Irish,
mostly Northern Irish.
So George Best.
Yeah, well done. Because quite hard to recognize some of the faces on there. Jamie Dornan. He was in a film called 50 Shades of Grey. So that's him up there. So the woman in the bondage and the guy beside him. So he's an actor from here. You can see that one up there.
So because Jamie Dornan is in 50 Shades, he gets his own mural in Northern Ireland.
Yeah.
That's amazing. So he's right next to a guy with a baseball bat.
Yeah.
Sorry, two guys with a baseball bat.
Yeah.
And then there's Jamie Dornan.
I'm not sure what that's.
Either that or that's the sequel to 50 Shades of Grey 4.
And then there's like, I'm not sure that there's a policeman there with some weed. I'm not even sure what, I don't know what that reference is, but. But what I like about these, I love these meals because there's a lot of little references to funny little, weird little Belfast stories.
Then there's an Icelandic elf there on the bottom there.
Yeah? Well, I think it's a homeless man.
Yeah, that's what we call Icelandic elves.
Okay.
But with all this divide in the city, I think it's time to ask the real question, which is, how does all this affect the comedy scene?
The comedy scene up here is, I'd actually call it stronger than in the south.
How's it?
It's incredible, yeah. It's like, the amazing thing about here, and like, I haven't really seen it in too many places in the world, is that the comedians are working together. It's fucking weird, man. They're all friends, they're all supporting each other, they're all helping each other grow, they're all fucking...
That's beautiful.
Beautiful. It's fucking rare.
So there's no, like...
comedians are like, do you hear about Dave, man? Fuck Dave.
The Northern Irish comedians help each other out loads. They try and create, like, an alternative circuit. There are people that are famous in Northern Ireland that are not heard of in the Republic of Ireland because they have their own society.
There's a far stronger community of wanting everyone to do better.
Yeah.
I think they maybe all sat down and went, hang on, if we start doing well, one of us starts doing well, or two of us start doing well, we'll all do better. And more people will be interested in coming to shows. And we'll lift each other up. We can do bigger venues, get TV and radio and fucking sponsorship deals. Cool as shit.
While I was in town, Irish comedian Alison Spittle, creator and host of The Alison Spittle Show, was headlining a gig at the Black Box in Belfast, and was actually nice enough to let me open for her.
There's a bit of a weird one tonight. Well, today. This afternoon. I've got a really special support act. He's from Iceland. The country. So it's very exciting. They're doing a documentary. They've done like comedy in the Ukraine and different places, and they were like, feck it, Belfast now. So you were in good company. And they run a comedy club in Iceland, so hopefully if I'm ever there, you'll give me a gig, yeah? Return the favour? So very, very... Oh, sorry, I was looking at... I was like, Helgi, sorry. So will you please give a big, massive round of applause and be very nice. It'll be lovely. I think it's going to be great crack. I've never seen like Icelandic comedy before. I'm excited. I like your music, you know what I mean? It's like, happy pole. Have that with the comedy, you know, it's very uplifting. I love it. And so, will you please give a big round of applause for Mr. Helgi Steinar, everybody?
All right, Belfast, how are you guys here today? Wonderful, thank you guys so much for that. Thank you, Allison, for letting me do this. This wasn't actually expecting to do comedy in the city. I just, you know, we just popped by, wanted to check out the scene, and then we talked to Allison in the back, and he was like, do you want to do a bit of comedy? I was like, well, sure, you know, we just got off the black cab mural torso. We're obviously locked and loaded for laughter, you know? So it's, fun times. This is amazing. It's my first time in Northern Ireland, first time in Belfast. I absolutely love the city. Me and my mate were just having a great last weekend here. I love the city. I love how every guy here under the age of 25 sports the exact one approved haircut. A sort of shave debt collector in training. They're awesome. They're like Northern Irish versions of the bad guys from Taken. It's great. So scary.
Does politics affect comedy in any way here? Or?
No, the Northern Irish love hearing any IRA joke.
Oh, yeah?
You have to make it a slightly more political for them. They like a good, like, just a local reference. And, I mean, their local references are terrorism, so...
Yeah, right, she has a problem, mate. So these immigrants coming over here, right, speaking Muslim, right, she has why right now we're working with the DUP to stop these migrants from coming here, eating our steak pies and drinking our flash fuck beers. That's what we believe, ain't that right, DUP? We don't even believe in abortions. And while we're on the subject, we're not too keen on that whole evolution thing either. I think it might be a plot by the Catholic Church to convert monkeys.
Like, you have to make some sort of local reference jokes, and that would be politics, but I think as well they want to break from it too.
The best way, the nicest way I've got robbed was I was cycling my bike and I was all delighted with myself, I was just chilling, had my laptop in the basket, just cycling, and this guy was able to jog up beside me. He wasn't even breaking a breath, he was just like, hey! And he just leaned in, took my laptop, and then jogged off again. And I was like, Alison, you need to make it more difficult for these people.
The North will put up with less shit.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I feel like, yeah. But they're harder to crack, but once you crack them, they're lovely, gooey insides.
If you have a cup of tea and you're still crying and panicking, you're fucked. Like, there is... There's something truly wrong there.
After hearing about all the violence in Northern Ireland, it was nice to finally have a little laugh. It was even nicer to see how the comedy scene in Belfast in no way reflects that divide that splits the very community in which they do their shows. But with all the laughs and good times, it's easy to forget the harsh reality that is creeping up on the country. No one knows what will happen after Brexit or how optimistic they should be. But at the end of the day, you can always count on that glass half full kind of mindset that the people in Ireland have always had.
It could be positive also, so.
It could be potentially for us, but I mean it could go back. It could reignite the troubles. So you're on the one hand, it could go back, but you know, but it depends on, unfortunately, the DUP, who are the most hostile, who have always been the most hostile to the Good Friday Agreement as well. And are in their spirits are hard Brexiteers. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So they're the one party, the entire of all the, there's lots of small parties in Northern Ireland. So like the majority of people in Northern Ireland who vote for those other parties are anti-Brexit. But the one party that is propping up the Tory government in England is very pro-Brexit and also probably philosophically hard Brexit. So they don't mind mentally, they don't mind if the border goes back, even though they know it can't really. So that's why we're fucked. Everybody.
Northern Ireland is at a weird time right now. Brexit is less than 1 month away, and if no deal is reached, that could mean that a hard border will reappear, which means that the troubles of the past will reignite, and violence may once again be an everyday issue for the people who live in this country. On the other hand, the Good Friday Agreement did show us that peace is possible in Ulster, and judging from what I've heard of most of the people I've talked to here, that seems to be what everybody wants, just to be able to go to the pub, have a pint, enjoy themselves with friends, and live a good life. At least, that's the Northern Ireland I've come to know.
When apples still grow in November, when blossoms still bloom on each tree, when leaves are still green in December, it's then that our land will be free. I wander your hills and your valleys, but still through my sorrow I see a land that has never known freedom and only a river.